let's focus more on credit risk analytics. And when you talk about credit risk analytics, the most important thing which comes in our mind is a bank's regulatory environment, which would be our most focus in this course. So, starting with, we will first talk about the different types of capital. Okay. Guys, can you see my screen? I'm on slide 3. Okay, great. So I received the answer. Okay. So I will keep it a bit generic right now when I talk about the types of capital. Now, what is capital? When you talk about the capital, it is actually related, it is a financial term, and it is a money which is used in day-to-day operations. And it talks about the financial health of the company. A quick example of capital would be my financial capital. So when you talk about the financial capital, it is the money which is required to keep the business up and running. So for any business, when you want to keep it running, money is required. And there are primarily two sources from which businesses get the money or capital to finance their operations. One is debt and one is equity. So if you see any of the company and you see the stock market, they're asking you to invest in their stocks, they're asking you to invest in their bonds. Okay. They are kind of, this is the kind of capital which a company raises. Now, when you talk about equity, as it is a investment in shares or stocks, so here the investors expect a certain rate of return. But, say for example, if you're investing in stock and the value goes down, the company may not repay you. So that is how equity capital is thought about. When you talk about debt capital, it is a kind of direct lending you are taking from a creditor. So here, paying back money is a part of the deal, and a company has to pay interest to the person who has paid the credit or the creditor. Now, when you talk about stocks or equity, they give the creditor a part in the ownership of the company. And they also get dividends, which are actually a proportional share of future profits. But in the debt capital, this part is missing. It's not there. But what is present is, in the debt capital, the person who has lent out the money to the company have a legal claim on the assets of the company. So in a way, debt capital is more risky for the company because if they fail to repay, the company can be taken over by the creditors. Another example is human capital. So this is a more intangible asset. It may or may not be properly quantified, but it is very important for running a business. So it basically involves, in terms of employees, their skills, education, and their abilities. And there are different factors that identify human capital, like skills and qualifications, intelligence, judgment, and so on and so forth. Then you talk about the economic capital. So these economic capital and regulatory capital are the most important concept here in terms of credit risk analytics, because you would be covering them. And this is the thing which is required either by regulatory bodies or by their banking suggestions which we get from Basel committees. Now when you talk about economic capital, it answers the question, how much financial capital does the business need to cover a future loss which is expected or unexpected? And why do banks need to give economic capital? For example, they undergo a loss and they are not able to finance that loss. Then bank has to shut down their business. Like it happened in 2008 to 2010 recession. The bank did not have enough capital to fund the losses which happened out of the subprime crisis. Now, economic capital is an internal measure which is calculated by the companies themselves. They use their own models, methodologies, and using them, they also take some of the strategic business decisions. However, there are some guidelines to calculate these economic capitals, which we will cover in a future slides. Another example is regulatory capital. So, any regulatory body in an economy, like you have Federal Bank in US, you have RBI in India, they want to ensure the healthiness of the banking system. And how do they do that? They certify that a minimum percentage of their profits or their outstandings, banks have to keep in terms of capital. And for that, banks have to do proper documentation submissions as well, that how they have actually come up to the value that this amount is enough for your regulatory compliance. So it's not that bank will, central bank or federal bank will say, you have to keep 10% of your money as a capital, 15% of the money. So it is actually the outcome of the models which you have to justify in terms of in front of the central bank. And then you arrive at that regulatory capital reserve. Now, okay. Now I will come to more specific part, which is your capital structure of the banks. Guys, I am on slide 8. Let me know if I'm not there. I'm continuing. I'm on slide 8, bank capital. So if you particularly talk about a bank, its capital structure is comprised of two main components. So one is the equity capital, another is supplementary capital. So when you talk about the equity capital, it is the same which we covered in the previous slide. It is the money raised through equity, through share markets. It is the investment of shareholders. When you talk about supplementary capital, it is the estimation. And the estimation which a bank does for any kind of provisions required to cover the future losses. Now, as it is a provision, it is an allowance, it is an idle money for the bank which would be lying in case some bad happening is there in the future. So, as a smart businessman, I will not like my money to be lying idle in my kitty. I would rather invest it in something or I would use it to expand my business further. So to resist that urge, the central bank or federal regulatory authorities have strong capital norms and regulations around this supplementary capital, so that banks cannot compromise against the provisions they have made in case some of the bad scenario or loss happens in the future. And they are able to withstand those losses, and the economic health of the banks and of the economy remains in place. Okay. Now, when you talk about the bank capital, they, as per Basel II, which we will be covering further, what is Basel? I will be covering that in the further slides. There are two tiers of capital. One is tier 1 and tier 2. And further, tier 1 is divided into tier 1 common capital and tier 1 capital. So two main divisions, tier 1 and tier 2. Now, when you talk about tier 1 common capital, it is a sum of common shareholders' equity minus any kind of goodwill capital, which is a kind of intangible asset, and any other kind of intangibles which are existing. Okay, so we want to exclude those values while we are calculating our capital. So only the core or the physical amount of capital present in the bank account is considered as the capital. Now, if you talk about the tier 1 capital, it also includes the shareholders' equity from preferred stocks and also includes your hybrid securities. Now, this tier 1 capital is the standard nomenclature. Whether you talk about any bank or any country, this remains common. Its components are also why we are excluding intangibles, Vishal, is because we cannot exactly quantify the value. Say, for example, the market reputation which a company has, that definitely can affect its earnings. And if I am appointed as a CEO, I might assign it a different value. Another person who is working in the company might assign it as a different value. So you actually cannot quantify it into a particular value. And say, for example, in terms of any crash or any kind of loss or any kind of misinformation flowing into the market, my goodwill or any kind of intangible or capital will suddenly, you know, move up and down. So there would be a lot of disturbances, a lot of peaks and troughs in the values. So that's why we cannot calculate exactly the value of goodwill and intangible. I think somebody asked a question on common and preferred stocks. Okay. So on a very higher note, so there are two types of stocks which a company issues. So for example, if I go out and buy a stock in the market. So this is the ordinary stock. So I just go there, I invest some money, and if the stock is doing good, I will get the return, and that's it. But there are some there are some preferential treatment given to some people who pay a bit more to buy preferred stocks. So preferred stocks have more features. They give more preferential rights to the people who are investing in it. For example, if you talk about the dividend payment, so any kind of dividend which is coming out of the profit generated by the company, they might be getting a higher percentage of that. Or if a company receives a very small amount of dividend, the company might decide to give it only and only to the preferred stockholders and not to common stockholders. So in a as the name suggests, preferred stocks have more preferential treatment for the stock investors. And if you talk about the hybrid securities, so they are kind of securities which have a both example of, they have both characteristics of equity like a stock or a debt like a bond. So a part of it can be a bond, a part of it can be equity, or they can be converted into each other at different intervals. Okay. Yeah. Guys, I hope you are all with me and everything is sinking in. Great, great, Vishal. Thanks for replying. Okay. Now, if you talk about the Tier 2 capital, so Tier 2 capital is more about the estimations. The estimations which a bank does for reserves and provisions. So this is the capital which a bank has to keep aside to provide a cushion against the losses. Now, if you talk about Tier 2 capital, it has the following composition. So any kind of debt, lease or losses or provision of bad debts. So these we will cover that more in the further slides. So Tier 2 capital is mainly comprised of these three parts, and it is reserved out of the profits which a bank earns. And as I explained earlier, the managers or the portfolio owners, they try to underreport these parameters. So what they want to project is, as a business leader, it's in their best interest to do not keep money idle in their kitty and keep it rolling in the market, maybe for investment or for further expansive purposes. And if they are keeping less money in this capital provisions, they also try to give a signal to the investors that, hey, we have done all the calculations and our investments are very less risky, so that we do not need to maintain a high amount of capital reserves. So that in that way, it also emboldens investors in a misleading way that the company is much more healthier than it actually is. Okay. So central bank play a very good role here. They have a set of regulations and directives through which a bank has to calculate this Tier 2 capital, so that they also meet shareholders' expectations in a realistic manner, and also they do not do under reserving, so that if any unfortunate event happens in the economy, they go bankrupt or they file for some losses. Okay, and if a bank in an economy is not following the Tier 2 capital norms, so the Federal Bank levies huge penalties on it, which may sometimes lead a bank to shut down its operations. So on and on, the total capital of a bank is a sum of Tier 1 and Tier 2 capital. Okay. Now we talk about the capital ratios. So these are the ratios which are actually calculated under the norms which are provided by Basel, which is a regulatory measure for calculating the capital. So guys, if we revise, a bank primarily faces three main types of risk. One is credit risk, which we studied, coming directly from the credit given to the customers. One is market risk, the risk which comes when the bank invests further the money, and the operational risk. Any kind of problem which happens in the operations of the bank due to which a risk arises, it's called operational risk. Now, if you talk about the bank, every bank has their own measure of risk, a own kind of risk which they would be facing in terms of the portfolio of the customers they are holding and the products they are providing. So to align all the banks under one umbrella, while they are facing different kinds of risk, the regulator has defined a metric called RWA, which is called risk weighted assets, so as to properly calculate the exposure of the banks to the risk. Under this, banks need to maintain their tier 1 capital, which includes tier 1 common capital and tier 1 capital, and tier 2 capital as well, related to their risk weighted assets. And this further will give rise to your capital ratios. Arti has left, I don't know why. So these are calculations are there for capital ratios. You can simply park them for right now. We will be covering them more and more while we are discussing Basel and building our models. But keep them as a definitions, because these are pretty standard. While any bank is doing their capital calculations. As I said earlier, the total risk weighted asset is the sum of CR, MR, and OR. When I say CR, MR, OR, this is credit risk, market risk, or operational risk. Tier 1 capital, common capital ratio is Tier 1 common capital divided by RWA. Similarly, our Tier 1 capital ratio and total capital ratio. Then you have leverage ratio. Now, as a regulator, their job is to bring all banks under one purview and their healthy businesses, while understanding the feature that every bank has a different mix of customers and a different mix of portfolio and type of products, and the way they function, the geography they function, is also pretty different. Now, central bank or federal bank, or under Basel II, these are the minimum capital requirements which every bank has to maintain. So after building models, using all the parameters of your bureau variables, all the variables, come up with capital calculation through statistical models. Out of that, they calculate their capital and then calculate the capital ratios. For Tier 1 common capital ratio, it should be greater than or equal to 2% all the time. So when you talk about the Basel models, which are built for 12 months, your Tier 1 common capital ratio for the future, 1 year of your operation, should be greater than 2%. Your Tier 1 ratio, which is your common and preferential ratio plus your hybrid, should be greater than 4% of all the times. Also, your tier one, tier two capital, which is your reserve capital, cannot exceed the tier one capital, and the leverage ratio should be greater than 3% of all debts. So these are the few things which you can park right now and keep it handy while you will be working and understanding the individual norms more, and they come back, and come back and understand these are the rules and regulations which are given by the central bank. So it's like a speed limit which you see on a road. While you're driving, you see the speed limit is 80. So these are kind of the limits, maximum or minimum limits, the central bank has given to different banks.